Once a year, far from any paved road and well off the beaten path, a rare collection of mountain bikers assemble near the outskirts of Zion National Park in southern Utah to stand on a precarious peak looking over the precipice and valley beneath them. Their goal is to make it to the bottom, navigating knife-edge ridges and cliff drops and doing so at incredible speeds while performing the most progressive tricks to date better than their fellow competitors. This is a sporting event that is unparalleled in nature in both sheer skill and danger. Welcome to the 10th anniversary edition of the most prestigious event in mountain biking. This is Rampage, and you're watching the Red Bull Signature Series. Sal Masichella here, your host of the Red Bull Signature Series, and allow me to welcome you to southern Utah and one of the most spectacular landscapes on this planet. You know, people visit from around the globe here to this part of the southwestern United States to stand in complete awe of this desert topography with its striking red rock formations that are really unrivaled anywhere, and today make it a setting for a competition unlike anywhere in the world. This is the holy grail of freeride mountain biking, and for the past week, riders have meticulously been shaping and manicuring their lines that will allow them to billy goat their way down through these rock cliff bands, across canyon gaps, and over massive man-made features, not only in the hopes of surviving a top-to-bottom run, but also to engineer tricks that were never thought possible on two wheels. These riders looking for their place in freeride mountain bike history. We are set and ready to go for our finals, so I'm going to toss it over to Todd Harris and the freeride legend, Mr. Cam McCall.
Thank you, Sal. This is the 10th edition of Red Bull Rampage. Cam, how important is it for the sport to keep evolving the way it has over the last 10 years?
Well, it's absolutely amazing to see where it started and where it is now. You look at the first year, everybody's just trying to figure out a way to survive from top to bottom. After year one, it was proven that it was possible, and now you build on that. Each event that they've held ever since, it has progressed double, you know, times two. So exponential progression, and now it's the 10th event, so it's no lie to say that it's progressed tenfold.
You've competed in four of these events. How prestigious is it just to get an invite here?
It's really prestigious to get an invite. That's the first hurdle. It's the proving ground out here, and just to get invited is a big benchmark to accomplish as a mountain biker. But then once you get here, the real challenge is proving yourself and proving to the world that you belong here.
Well, the format is simple, Cam. Best of two runs. They are scored out of 100. What are the judges looking for?
With this being an interpretive contest, the riders get to choose their lines. So line choice is definitely the most important judging criteria. And then your favorites, of course, from other contests, speed and fluidity, amplitude, and of course, tricks.
Let's check in with the fourth member of our crew. Here's Tina Dixon.
Guys, we talk so much about the drops that these athletes are doing and the tricks that we forget just the exposure that these athletes are having to face just to get to where they are performing their tricks. There is such a small room for error. In fact, walking along this track, your natural instinct as a human is to come as close to this wall as possible. So this is some of the stuff that these athletes are having to face. And you know, I got a chance to walk up to Brandon Semenek's first drop and I talked to him about it and I said, you know what, that was absolutely terrifying going up there. But he pointed out to me, well, from our point of view, it's safer on our bikes, guys.
Tina, definitely the bravest member of our crew, and we get things started off at the top here in Virgin, Utah. Ryan Howard, the 27-year-old from Aptos, California, will have the honors of dropping in first. Now, Cam, as we said, you've competed here before. How critical is it to get a first run under your belt?
It's very important. You never know what the conditions are going to do throughout the day, so Ryan Howard dropping first is definitely a good advantage. Looks like the winds are low. We're going to drop Ryan Howard.
And off he goes. Now remember, it is important to know he has 4 minutes to get from the top to the bottom. That's usually not a factor, and he is off to a very quick start.
This guy is the rider's rider. People look up to him because he has such great style. He makes everything look so easy. So the line that he's chosen down this course definitely plays toward his strengths, gives him the opportunity to do some tricks, but also the opportunity to tick that style box on the judge's scorecard. Missing a trick on that trick jump there, but doing that classic Ryan Howard style, going deep outside on that hip jump, now pointing it straight down into a more technical section of his line. Ooh, I like the way he hipped back up top to connect back to that ridge. Ryan Howard jumping across those two doubles, manually almost turning that section into a pump track. I know he's got a drop right here. Let's see if he can trick it. A suicide no-hander off the step down off that cliff. Ryan Howard sharing this line with some of his closest riding buddies, making his way down here to a wood-to-dirt booter.
And just carrying a ton of speed.
Whoa, huge upside-down corked out 360 on that wood-to-dirt feature.
So Ryan Howard is going to get to the bottom, a full pull and a little style as he comes into the finish corral. Ryan Howard top to bottom, very clean.
Nice no-foot can there. Three tricks in that run, linking it all together with amazing classic Ryan Howard style. We're going to take a look back at this cliff drop, pinching the seat with his knees, taking both hands off, landing low on that transition, definitely getting the trick score as well as the style score. Nobody does a 360 quite like Ryan Howard. And the no-footed can to finish things off, perfect way to start this event.
So Ryan Howard, the first man down here in run number one at Rampage. The score comes in at a 66.75. That becomes the mark to beat. Well, the riders today have some heavy lines to choose from. Let's take a deeper look in the course preview.
Hey guys, Kelly McGarrett here. We're here at 2015 Red Bull Rampage. We're here at the top of the course. And I'm gonna take you top to bottom for a course preview.
All right guys, here we go. Dropping in on this ridge line. It's super exposed up here. It's like the smallest drop. It's actually pretty scary. But it's so cool to ride down here. Come along the ridge here. Watch out for my bugs on that wall. Drop out of the line, yeah boys. Drop down here. Now we're actually on the line I'm riding. On this ridge line, good speed check here. Coming to this right hip. Woo! There we go. And now we're gonna drop them here. So lift and hip drop. There we go. Oh yeah, it's nice and smooth. Come along here. Yeah boys! Woo! Dropping to my buddy Howie's line here. Bit of a double drop. Drop off there. There we go. Oh, a little step over here. And then a big old step down here. Woo! Bang. Little jump here. Woo! Need to remember where to go here. Go left this jump. This last. Step down. Yep. Straight down and finish corral. That's it. Top to bottom, Red Bull Rampage 2015. Yeah, buddy.
And our thanks to Kelly McGarry. Cam, you've done this before. That just looks so heavy, the way he covered that course so quickly.
How cool is that? People always ask it, what's going through your head when you're riding Rampage? Well, strap a camera to it, and if you convince the rider to talk, then you'll know what's going on through their head.
We have Remy Metallier on deck. But first, let's take a look at the action we missed while we were away.
Well, Brendan Fairclough, another crowd favorite, a free racer as they call him. He spends most of the year traveling the World Cup circuit, battling the clock, but he always makes time for Rampage. And everybody loves his creative approach to the mountain, kind of has more unique features than anybody. He looks at this mountain a little bit differently based on his background, but doing a backflip is definitely something that not everybody was expecting to see out of this racer.
Always good when Brendan shows up. His score on run number one is a 77. Now remember, it's two runs. We only keep your best scores. We go back to the top of the course here in Virgin, Utah. Get an idea of just how steep it is. Next man set to drop in from Nice, France. This is 24-year-old Remy Metallier.
Really cool to see Remy Metalia dropping in right after Brendog, because they're both kind of similar athletes in the sense that they have the racer background and the racer approach. But the way they differentiated themselves out here is by their line choice. Brendog doing something that is very unique, traversing the hill. Remy Metalia decided to go as fast as possible on the middle of the course where you see a lot of other people riding. But riding this section so much faster than everybody else, he's trying to tick that fluidity and style marker on that judge's score sheet.
So Remy Metalier on course now, and as he's pointed out by Cam McCall, the speed at which he is working is absolutely amazing. As we went on board with him, you can see just how narrow this course is for him.
This guy spends a lot of time in Whistler, BC, the most popular bike park in the world. No stranger to big jumps.
Oh.
Biggest jump on the course right there, a 75-foot canyon gap. Taking his hands off, pulling himself out of his comfort zone, doing a suicide no-hander off the biggest jump on the course. One last jump for Remy Metalier. Not able to get a trick on that one. But lots of tabletop style on that hip. A smooth one in the bag for Remy Metalier.
Well, we saw him suicide that last jump in qualifying. How much is that going to hurt him on his score?
Well, it's probably going to hurt him a little bit because the judges know what he was planning on, but now he has something to build off of for that second run. So this is the part of the line where we were looking at his POV footage from before. Right now you can fully enjoy how fast he's going on that steep technical descent. And here's the biggest jump on the course. We talked about that, the canyon gap. Suicide no-hander. Credit to the builders on that one. The landing is so smooth this year. You wouldn't know that he came from so high in the air landing that smooth.
Remy Metalier has completed one of his two runs here at Rampage. What will the score be? The mark to beat is a 77, and he picks up an 80. So the Frenchman moves into first place. A very impressive run from him, and we'll see what he has in run number two. This is Sam Reynolds set to drop in on his first run of two. Now remember, the mark to beat just laid down moments ago by Francis Remy Metalier, and now Sam Reynolds from the UK is on course.
Sam Reynolds has been making waves in the slopestyle scene for a long, long time, but this year he's kind of been joining up with the Fest Series guys. It's a grassroots group of riders kind of focused on that big bike kind of riding, and it's mainly purposed to have a good time, but it also doubles as a great way to get ready and prepare for Rampage. So Sam Reynolds was able to make it out of the qualifying round yesterday, and he's in the finals.
Sam having a great start so far. A little different, a little more meticulous than we saw from Remy, not going quite as fast, but this view, you wouldn't know it because he is absolutely blitzing this ridgeline.
Well, Sam had his own step down that got him onto that ridge too. Now he's connecting into the run into this canyon gap. A trick rider, let's see what he's got over this huge gap.
Oh, goodness!
A fully extended Superman over the 75-foot gap. Biggest trick we've ever seen off of that jump this year.
So some high risk, high rewards from Sam Reynolds. And there he comes unglued completely and finds the seat.
The Sidewinder, a freestyle motocross influence trick. Feet off the side, hands off the bars, running, and a nice stylish tabletop to finish things off. That was a huge run.
Unbelievable, Cam, as he comes through. He is absolutely stoked on finishing that one. What a run by Sam Reynolds. I think we may have a new leader.
Well, we've got to look back at the canyon gap. Here it is. There's that perfect moment right in the middle. Click. Fully extended Superman over the huge gap, once again landing so smooth. Builders creating a better landing on that thing this year. You can go a couple bike lengths deep and still land smooth, but this was my favorite part right here. Feet off to the side, running, hands off the bars. It's called the Sidewinder. You don't expect to see it on a mountain bike, and you sure as heck don't expect to see it at Rampage in the middle of a run.
So Sam Reynolds really giving the judges something to think about on run number one here in Virgin. As the score comes down, it's an 83, and Sam Reynolds has gone into first place. What an amazing run by Sam Reynolds, now the current leader. We're here in Virgin, Utah, celebrating the 10th edition of Rampage. This is the spot of some of the most progressive riders on the planet. Up next, from France, Antoine Bizet. Now, he's got his hands full because a mark was just laid down moments ago by none other than Sam Reynolds. The mark to beat is an 83.
That's a tough mark to beat, but seriously, if anybody can do it, this is a guy right here. Antoine Bizet, despite being from France, he spends more time in Virgin, Utah than most of the riders in this field. He loves it out here. He comes out here on his own time to vacation, film video parts. And I've been watching him as he's been building. He's got some great plans set up, and he's just got that look in his eye, knowing that he's got something secret to pull out.
Working his way around the backside of the ridge line, and now he will come back into view for the thousands of fans who have made the trek here to watch the very best in Virgin.
Well, he's wasting no time pointing this thing straight down the mountain. That was a big drop right there, getting the technical scorecard filled out. A suicide no-hander drop off of that thing. Oh, front flip! Back up top of the ridge. And he's able to connect into his run, and he's got his own drop into this canyon gap. It's bigger than the other options. Lands that perfectly. It gives him a little bit more speed into the canyon gap.
Oh, he flips it!
A backflip going so long, but able to hold on.
Almost looked like he was overcooking it, Cam, and here he comes down. One more big feature to go.
Well, he's got such a deep bag of tricks. Which one will he choose? A backflip.
A double backflip! And 23-year-old Antoine Bazet is down. What a fall. But let's talk about this run, Cam. It had a little bit of everything.
So many highlights. Let's go back and check them all out. That suicide no-hander drop, and this one really caught me off guard. Front flipping down from the bottom of that little basin, making it back up to the top of the ridge, getting that trick and enabling himself to connect to his unique line into the canyon gap. Of course, in true Antoine Bazet style, flipping the canyon gap. And then this was the highlight. Unfortunately, it ended up being the low light. The double backflip coming up just inches short and getting bucked down to the flat bottom.
And it looks like Antoine's day is done as the medical staff attends to him, but I tell you what, he absolutely went for it.
It's so hard to balance out pushing the boundaries but then staying safe. That's the first time anybody's ever tried a double backflip in Rampage competition.
Pushing the limits on lines and builds is a definite factor here at Rampage, and something our next rider knows all too well. For more on him, let's check in with Sal.
Cam Zink. This guy is one of the biggest madmen in the sport and has provided some of the more iconic moments in the history of Rampage. A 360 off the sender for a win in 2010. He also did a backflip off the same feature in 2013, as well as last year pulling off one of the most maniacal 360 drops ever done on a mountain bike. But as this guy continues to go bigger and bigger each year on his bike, he also has undergone a major life change, as he's now a husband and father. So how does that rider that everyone expects to go bigger and bigger manage to balance that role as a family man?
You just need a good woman. You know, behind every good man's a good woman, and I wouldn't be able to do it without Amanda. I put her through the ringer. You know, she's been crying on national TV year in, year out. As you know, any pregnancy can lead to a little bit more emotions, and I'm not doing any help for that. With the family, I have an almost two-year-old daughter, Ayla, and Amanda. We just got married. I think our anniversary was yesterday, our first month anniversary. Any father would know you can't tell anyone about it, you can't explain it, but you're a changed person forever. And you want to just hang out with them and just watch them giggle and smile, and you tell everyone else in the world, but they wouldn't understand. But it still makes it a little harder to ride. You know, it's like you have to coordinate your day and plan it out a lot more, and I have so many other business ventures going on right now. I started a grip company in 2009 called Census. We sell mostly grips, and that gave me the opportunity to bring over YT, it's a successful brand in Europe who I rode for, over to North America. And my brother and I run the North American franchise.
A lot of these athletes out here today, you know, they're still living with their parents, and then you fast forward to, you know, guys like Zink, you know, they have kids, they got a family to support, they got mortgages, you know, they're stepping into businesses.
That was a little quick.
I still just feel like a kid riding his bike out there, and I'm doing the exact same thing they're doing. I'm trying to find the best line, build the best line, and then win. We're all in the same boat, and kind of funny to think I'm the only dad out there. And Cam McCall's sitting over there, you know, commentating, doing the responsible thing for his family. Mountain biking is my job, but it's still the best job in the world. And like any job, you're gonna hustle as hard as you can to feed your family.
I think having children and getting married would maybe slow down most people, but I don't think you can stop Cam Zink.
I just wanna live to my potential, and I always try to find something. Like, I wanna do the biggest thing I can, and I found it. Like, I always find it out here.
He blows my mind every single Rampage, so I'm definitely looking forward to seeing what he's gonna do, and I don't think he's gonna slow down anytime soon.
This guy is amazing. Cam Zink, he puts so much on his plate, and somehow he's always able to eat it all. All those things that he just listed, the business ventures, the family, being a contest rider, on top of all that, he's got a separated SC joint in his shoulder right now. You can see the tape under his shirt. A lot of people look at that as a great excuse to not compete in Rampage. Nope, he's up here looking to put down the run of his life.
And he called you sensible. So 83 is the mark to beat, put up by Sam Reynolds. Here is American Cam Zink, 29 years of age, out of Reno, Nevada, dropping in on run number one.
You can see he's revisiting his line from last year. Basically, he's so ambitious. The idea that he had planned last year wasn't able to finish at all. But it starts out with this steep technical shoot that he and Kyle Strait pioneered last year with a rock saw in order to make that rideable. He links it into this section of the course that nobody else is riding. You can see he's watered some of those little landings there in order to slow down enough. That's a triple drop. He touches down three times, linking back in his trail, and this is the bread and butter of the run. Oh, he spins it again. 360 drop. That's the one that he did last year. And he kind of just cruised to the finish line after that last year. But this year, he's got so much more added to this run. That's his own canyon gap. You can see Amanda and Ayla right there cheering him on. He's still got another huge trickable feature to go. Oh, and he backflips that huge step down. Oh, man, this run is a two-year project. So amazing to see him kind of just filling in the blanks. He knows why he didn't score well last year, and now he's created more trickable features in the middle of this run, and now he's connected back onto a common section of this course. He's able to just kind of flow it through the finish line.
Almost a ride for redemption for Cam Zink as he comes through this time. As you mentioned, a two-year project, and this time, start to finish, that was clean.
It's got to feel amazing to pull that off after 2 years of just dreaming about it.
So with his wife and daughter looking on, Cam Zink lays down a beautiful first run here in Virgin.
And so many highlights of this run. This replay is gonna view like a highlight reel right there. It's got steep and technical. It's got these drops right here that have to be linked together perfectly. If you overshoot one of them, it derails the entire train. And of course, right here, the 360 drop. The biggest dirt-to-dirt natural terrain 360 drop in the history of mountain biking. He did it twice last year. Now, for the third time in a row, stomps it here in 2015. And the icing on the cake this year is this backflip step down. Nobody knew that it was possible to come up with a new trickable step down at the bottom of the course. He found it.
Unbelievable run for the young man out of Reno, Nevada, with his wife and daughter looking on. The mark to beat was an 83, and Cam Zink goes 89.25 to go into first place. And he's now standing by with our Tina Dixon.
Cam, what a huge run. The top section was already flawless, especially with that 360. How close was that to what you had thought of in your mind?
Well, last year I went, there's kind of a knuckle, it's not really casing it, it's just like a little bump in it, and I landed above that last year both times. This year I'm like, I'm going deep, I'm gonna get that greasy landing, overcooked it a little bit, but that landing's like vert, so it held me on, and tire held on, and I'm like, wait for it to pop, and I'm like, all right, we're good. Made the hip and just started cranking, because the bottom half of my run is kind of a two-year project, because like last year we only had time to finish the first part, the upper half. And the meat and potatoes, but then the bottom, I got killed for the road last year, you know, for riding along the road. So this year, me and my boys finished that little canyon gap and made a big flip step down, and then almost undercooked that. But yeah, it's so pumped.
Well, it was packed full. Everyone loved it. What a great run, guys.
Thank you, Tina. The mark to beat 89.25, put up by that man, Cameron Zink. Right now, let's check in with Sal Masekela.
The canyon gap. It is an ominous presence that looms over this arena. History has been made by those who clear it safely and those who are able to walk away from it in one piece. Tom Van Steenbergen burst onto the scene last year, attempting the first ever front flip over the 70-footer. Unfortunately, Tom got broken off during practice and is going to have to sit out this year's event. However, his brother and first-time Rampage competitor Baz managed to secure that final qualifying spot and make it into the finals. With a little bit of sibling support, the Van Steenbergen brothers hope to prove that they are a force to be reckoned with at this, the biggest event in their sport.
Well, I'm very, very proud, you know, that they're both in Rampage. It's just absolutely unbelievable.
Tom's been there twice. And now Bass has been invited.
Bass is pretty much the one who
actually got me into riding.
My brother and I have been riding together since we were little, obviously, but we've definitely kind of gone into different styles of the sport, I guess.
I'm more jumpy, slopestyle stuff.
360 downside, tail whip.
Then he races downhill.
They're such different characters. They fought a lot, they still fight a lot.
I definitely beat you in some BMX races.
Well, that's BMX.
Yes, I have definitely beaten Babs.
No, more than once. Where, in which race?
I can't remember. No. Remember that four girls race?
Yeah, that's like literally the only one.
In Abbotsford.
Yeah.
No. But biking, they have in common.
Rampage. It's cool to have like a similar goal again, and we've been riding lots together.
For Rampage, I've chosen to prepare for it with my brother because he just rides a lot of different terrain that I usually ride. So definitely brings together both of our disciplines.
Every time we ride together, we still ride as hard as we can. There's never like a mellow ride between the two of us.
Well, obviously, I'm definitely going to be rooting for my brother because he's my brother, but I definitely want to beat him. I don't want him to beat me, but I want him to do well.
Yeah, getting here, it's definitely a little bit of padding pressure, obviously.
Started riding here, felt good. Everything went fine until I tried the canyon gap.
Get it!
Cased it pretty good and had to pull out, unfortunately, but stoked to see my brother. I'm excited to just watch him and have no pressure on myself now. I'm just gonna be nervous for him.
So with his brother Tom unable to go this year, it is all up to Bass representing the family name of Van Steenbergen. Now, the 21-year-old dropping in for his first time here at Rampage. Cam, think back to the first time you came and competed this event. What was it like?
Yeah, it can be very overwhelming, but Bass is one of those guys who has a very precise riding style and very calculated as well. So it's great to see him and his brother both coming out here and interpreting this mountain in completely different ways. They represent the yin and yang of the opposite ways to interpret freeride mountain biking. Tom with the crazy tricks and Bass with just the precise style.
So as he picks his way through this craggy mountain here in Virgin, Utah, carrying a lot of speed, remember the mark to beat is an 89.25 put up by American Cam Zink.
So we'll get to enjoy Bass Van Steenbergen's style on this run because he's got a full sequence of hips, slash corners, nose bonks on this run. If he can link it all together, he's definitely going to get a lot of points for fluidity. There we go, nice whip on that hip coming into a nose bonk. There we go on that floating rock feature that they chiseled out of the side of the mountain. Now this is where he starts manualing and pumping to pick up a ton of speed. He's got a longer gap here than a lot of the other riders who ride this section. Gapping so far with classic Bass Van Steenbergen style, smooth through the finish. You can look up the hill and see his dust trail exactly where he came from.
Very technical run for Bass as he makes his way down here in the final for the first time for this young man. Was it big enough? Did it have the wow effect that judges are looking for?
Well, it may not have had tricks, but this isn't a slopestyle contest. This is a big mountain freeride contest. Your line choice is very important and your style on that line. So right there, just kind of moving the bike in ways that other riders don't move the bike. You can see a silhouette of this guy and tell that it's Bass Van Steenbergen. That nose bonk right there, also really creative. Things that are going to help him play toward his strengths.
So a good first run for Bass Van Steenbergen. His score comes in at a 70.50. That puts him into fifth place for the time being. And he's standing by now with Tina Dixon.
And Bass, your first Rampage ever, you said you just wanted to qualify. So what's your impression of riding here in the finals, especially with your brother watching?
It's good, for sure. I could hear him screaming on the way down. And yeah, no, it's just a good time. A little less stressful than trying to qualify. So yeah, it's fun.
What's your impression of that first run? Watching you ride, you have the style and the judges definitely reward that.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I don't know. It's a good time riding down that mountain.
All All right, well, it was fun to watch. Guys, we'll send it back to you.
All right, thank you, Tina. The youth is still in effect here in Virgin, Utah. We go from Bass Van Steenbergen at 21 to 22-year-old Brett Reeder, the fellow Canadian, and this guy has ridden his bike all around the world. But again, this becomes the mecca for these guys to come back to Virgin, Utah.
So great to see this guy, a world-class athlete out of Ontario, out of all places, competing at Rampage. He's become such a well-rounded mountain biker. And I remember a few years ago riding his first Rampage, feeling like he didn't belong. But right now, it's obvious watching him ride down that steep section, going right down the belly of the beast of this course, that he belongs. A 360 drop.
So big, high risk, high rewards early for Reeder.
Reeder riding a similar line to last year. He did that last year, a flat drop backflip, no lip to help him initiate the rotation there. He's got to get all the way behind the bike. Way more technical than if there's a lip, and another 360 drop. So this is a guy who follows the FMB World Tour, competing mostly on slope style and dirt jump competitions, and he comes out here every year to try to get points for that overall, but also just to push himself as an overall mountain biker. And man, he has evolved so much in the last few years.
Having a great run here, and look at this, the last big feature, and he backflips it.
Big backflip. He was looking for a combo there. I saw his bars in his lap. He wanted to take the hands off. That's what he did last year, and I know the judges love him if you can get a trick into that backflip, get the variation points, but all in all, top to bottom, he had two 360 drops, a flat drop backflip, and a flip over the last double. That was a great run.
So the Canadian wheels into the finish corral. The big question now for him and the judges, is it enough to take down Cam Zink's 89.25? Look at this view.
You can see from his POV footage how incredibly steep it is at the start. He's a fierce competitor. He knows how to strategize, so he has the steep technical stuff, but he also has the tricks that you normally only see on a slope-style contest. That flat drop backflip, this drop 360, he had two of those in that run.
So Brett Reeder's score comes in and run number one in our two-run format. It's an 81.50, so that will put him in the top three for the time being. Cam Zink continues to lead the way with his family at his side. An 89.25 is the mark to beat as we head to the very top of the mountain and check out Kyle Norbrotten, who is ready for his first run of two, the 29-year-old from Prince George, British Columbia.
Kyle Norbrotten is such a fan favorite out here. Everybody loves watching him ride. And it was cool seeing Brett Reeder drop in that run. He had two 360 drops. Kyle Norbrotten was actually the first guy to ever do two 360 drops in the span of one Rampage run a few years ago. And that's really what gained him such a huge following.
Big drop to start things off for Kyle as he's on course now, picking his way through this area. He's got this thing memorized, but how difficult when you're throwing backflips out there, can you get lost on this mountain?
Oh, well, seriously, everything kind of looks the same, so you have to memorize every little bit and piece of this. He's following a similar route that we just saw Brett Reeder ride, except where Brett did that first three drop, Kyle Norbrotten just did a backflip. I didn't even know he had a kicker placed up there on the mountain, so that definitely is going to surprise the judges and definitely kind of pushing him outside his comfort zone. So now making things a little bit more technical right now with a slow plumb bobber. I think he's got another trickable drop here. He does a 360 drop. Oh man, over rotating a little bit, throwing up a nice dramatic plume of dust.
And just carrying a ton of speed, Cam.
Oh, he needed a trick on that jump. Nice stylish one-handed table type of thing and another table to finish things off. Well, it's not that big of a deal that he missed a trick on that last jump because he had that step down flip and that 360 drop, a ton of smooth fluid style linking everything together. Good job, Norbs.
So Kyle Norbrotten, a clean pole start to finish on run number one. This should get him in the top five. Very technical. He had the big drops. There you see him hugging his buddies. 89.25, though, is the magic number.
Well, you got the steep and technical. Check. Linking it into trickable features. Check with that step down backflip. So blind, I can only imagine he wasn't able to see that landing until he was already on it. And then exactly what he's known for, 360 drops at Rampage, throwing up a nice plume of dust, classic Norb style.
And the score now coming down for Kyle, it's going to be an 80.50, so he is in the top five, checks in fourth place right now, so two Canadians right now holding down the top four positions as we go back to the top, and this man, another Canadian, 24-year-old Brandon Seminook out of Whistler, B.C.
Well, this guy, he's just forever pushing the boundaries of what's possible on a mountain bike. He's the most well-rounded guy out there. He can win any slopestyle contest on any given day. He's actually won Rampage before when he's a young kid in 2008. He got a podium last year, and he's been adding more spice to his line this year, so I can't wait to see what he's been planning.
Look at this drop. Oh!
Such a tall drop with no gap out, super blind. Oh, and another flat drop backflip right there for Brandon. We saw Brett do that, but Brandon doing it on a new feature that didn't exist in his line last year. Then reminiscent to his winning run in 08, that suicide no-hander up on top of the ridge, and talk about style, that whipped out nose bonk. Here we go, he's got this lily pad. He jumps onto that pad right there on an opposite 360. That's his unnatural direction. Can only hint at the fact that maybe he's thinking about doing something in his regular direction here before the end of this run. He's got a trick jump here. Oh, it's gonna be a backflip, one-footed can on that trick jump, getting a ton of speed, one more hit. Oh! A corked out flat spin 450, his natural direction. Of course, he's such a master of strategizing a run. I knew he was gonna have a natural rotation somewhere before the finish line. There it was, very well balanced run. All the criteria checked and a ton of tricks.
Brandon Semenuk, from top to bottom, he had a little bit of everything technical. And how about this first huge drop?
He's the only one who rides it. It has no gap. You literally can't do a practice run into it because you would fall off the cliff. So it's full commitment all the way. That nose bonk right there, there's going to be kids trying to imitate that for the next couple years. And of course, the opposite 360. You wouldn't know it's opposite unless you know Brandon, because he makes it look so smooth. Backflip one-footed can, taking his foot and putting it over the top of the bike to add in that variation trick. Then here's that natural direction, flat spin 450, 450 degrees of rotation, because that jump is hip, landing it perfectly.
So Brandon Semenuk's first run is in the books, and the score comes in a 94 even, and Semenuk goes into first place.
A huge score. We're into the 90s, a 94. That's gonna be tough to beat.
Yeah, and the second rider ever in Rampage history to actually get in the 90s with that 94. And you and your build crew had the opportunity to fine-tune your line with this Rampage. How effective was that for you?
Oh, so effective, just because last year was so much to build, and then this year we got to actually go back, build all the things we wanted to do, and like tweak it, make it perfect. And now the line's so rad. Like, it's so much funner, faster, more airs, and it's good stuff.
You came down here so pumped up. Just what's your initial reaction to that line?
I mean, it's just like so nerve-wracking being at the top of the hill, and just to like stare down it for like an hour watching your buddies ascend it, ascend it, ascend it, so nerve-wracking. So like you get to the bottom, you're just like, yes, made it, I'm not at the top of the hill anymore. It's just like, you know, even if you ride the ridge down, it's like it's a relief every time.
Well, you did it in a huge score, guys.
Thank you, Tina. The bar has been raised to 94. Right now, let's check in with Sal Masekela.
Thank you, Todd. As you can see, we got the greatest fans ever here, just chilling, watching these guys go nuts. You folks at home, who are you fired up about this year? Who's got the craziest line? Why don't you get involved with us, with the people, get in the conversation? You can follow the Red Bull Signature Series on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Plus, you can hit up the hashtag Rampage on social media. Plus, go to RedBullSignatureSeries.com, where we have even more exclusive content for you. And if that's not enough, you can download the Red Bull TV app and you can watch this show and every episode from every season. You are welcome.
Canada's Brandon Semenuk now holding the top spot with a 94 even. He laid that down just a few moments ago. We have Tomas Janone in the gates ready for his first run. But Cam, let's go back and check out some of the action we missed while we were away.
We just saw Pierre-Edward Ferry. He's actually a rider who's sharing parts of his line with Thomas Chenon, our next rider to drop. And this is a guy who is the oldest competitor in the field right now at 34 years of age. A lot of people kind of start slowing down at 34, but Pierre is one of those very precise riders like we were talking about with Bas van Steenbergen before. He's always putting his bike in exactly the right spot. So to see him flip the razor jump down here at the bottom of the course, it's a huge jump, taking himself outside of his comfort zone a little bit. Good to see.
His score is 78.50, and you are looking now at Brett Reeder, currently in second place in the FMB Diamond Series. And for Brett, it's the battle within the war, Cam. Although he's focusing on Rampage, the score he gets here will seriously impact his overall in that series.
Yeah, you have to think about one thing at a time, Rampage first and foremost, but the points gap between these two riders, Thomas Chinon and Brett Reeder, for the FMB overall, very coveted crown, it's so small that whoever takes the cake here and finishes ahead of the other guy will be the FMB World Tour overall champion.
So here he is, Thomas Chinon out of Belgium, as the international field continues to attack this unbelievable course. And this young man, he is just stellar, the skills he has on a bike.
And he's looking so much more comfortable on the big bike every year he comes out at Rampage. He's been coming out for a few now, and you know, being so close to winning FMB overall crown, that could be huge for his career. And he's got everything necessary to be able to pull that off. Well, he's coming into a bit, he decides to double that step down. He's usually been riding that in two stages, touching down twice. We decided to gap the entire thing. Huge amplitude points. And a backflip tuck no-hander with huge extension. That's what put him in the middle of this race for the FMB overall. Huge extension on tricks in the slopestyle world. He's able to adapt that here to the rugged terrain of Rampage.
Cam, this has gotta be a top three run. When he doubled that section that he's been dabbing down in, he absolutely covered some serious elevation in one big chunk.
I actually can't believe he did that. At the start of this run, I knew what he had planned because he's been working on this line for a long time. That technical drop right there, pointed straight down the mountain, steep technical. He overshot a little bit on this, but was able to muscle through, focus ahead on the next feature. The suicide no-hander, of course, up top, getting more and more tricks, but here's the amplitude score right here. Doubling this step down. Nobody's ever gone from the top to that bottom landing right there. It's actually a Paul Bassagodia feature from last year. And then that backflip tuck no-hander, really finishing this run off on the right foot.
So Thomas Chinon waiting for his score to come down. Where will it put him? Remember, it's a two-run format. We only keep your best score, and run number one will be a good one. 91.25, Chinon in second place behind Semenuk, and Cam Zink, the American, is now been bumped into third. Well, the conditions here in Virgin have been great all week, but there's always that threat of the wind picking up, which it often does in the afternoon, as we are back on top of the mountain. This is 29-year-old Paul Bassagodia set to drop in on his first run of two.
Well, this guy is such a legend in the sport. He's done so much in the slopestyle world. The first guy to ever win back-to-back Crankworx slopestyle titles. And this is the one event that he still does throughout the year, and he's got a very unique line that he started last year. Nobody's riding this far rider's right except for Paul Bass. He's got his very own canyon gap, natural double over a ravine coming up. Oh, and he backflips it! He wanted to do that so bad last year. Oh, and a 270 to connect back up onto the ridge. I did not expect to see him spin the bike to connect back over here to the ridge.
Paul Bass has got a good one here. This is run number one from Rampage.
He's got the trick so far, the style, the fluidity. What's he gonna do? He's getting a lot of speed into this step down. Going really long on that step down that we just saw Thomas Chinon ride. Oh, out of control. Wow, losing control and falling off that ledge there.
A lot of speed, and unfortunately for Paul Bass, he goes down.
Accomplishing such a huge long-term personal goal for him, backflipping that canyon gap. I know he's been thinking about it every day since he built that thing last year, and then doing that 270-degree spin to connect back up onto the ridge. He had some manuals up top, and then this, the huge step down, landing even further than Thomas Chinon, and getting wrapped up in the bushes right here, like a rodeo bull rider trying to just recover and hold on. But he got sent right off that next ledge.
So Paul Bassagodia is down on the course here in run number one, being attended to by the medical staff. We'll step aside. We'll be back with more Rampage. You're watching the Red Bull Signature Series. Welcome back to Virgin, Utah. This is the Red Bull Signature Series, and you're watching Rampage. Earlier, Paul Bass went down with a serious injury, and for an update on his condition, we check in now with Tina Dixon.
Yeah, thanks, Todd. After speaking with officials, here is what we know right now. Paul is conscious, and he is being transported to a local hospital for further evaluations. If I get anything more, I will let you know. But standing down here, you know, Paul's not only a fan favorite, but he is a rider's favorite, and everyone's wishing him the best.
The 29-year-old from Minden, Nevada. We send out our very best for a speedy recovery. And now we check in with Sal Masekela.
If there is a sentimental favorite here over the years, it has to be Graham Agassi. This is the only event that he competes in all year, and most fans have expected him to be on the podium at least once over the share of 3 years. But with a combination of bad luck and just an all-or-nothing drive, somehow he has managed to come up short consistently. Aggie, as he's affectionately known in the sport, is overdue, and his fans and fellow competitors would like nothing more than to see him finally get a win.
Yeah, boy!
Aggie's not really like a contest guy. This is the only contest he really does.
Ew!
For me, I think he's really the true free rider, you know? And this place really defines his riding style.
He gets that first drop.
He's always a people's favorite.
Yeah, Aggie is one of my favorite bike riders.
We're all rooting for him.
He's like one of the dudes that we all look up to the most, you know, like sickest rider.
That style goes for it.
He's just an all-around badass, so I'm pumped to watch that kid ride and hopefully stay safe out there.
Every year he does get so close.
Aggie's been winning like all the qualies like in the last 3 years.
Everyone that's either placed well in the past or done well the previous year gets pre-qualified for it. He's never had that. He's like the best bike rider ever, and he still has to qualify.
Your number one qualifier. Let's hear it for Aggie.
Qualify first today, like a year ago and 2 years ago.
He's just, for some reason, had the worst luck ever here.
He's been so close, whether it's just luck in his front tire.
Massive transfer. Oh, and Aggie goes down on the wall transfer.
So close.
Or blowing his knee out last year and after qualifying first, and it's been heartbreaking.
It's kind of crazy every year. It's just that close for Aggie, and I think he deserves it more than anyone.
I can't wait to like ride finals with him tomorrow, and just we're actually sharing the same line, and just can't wait to like watch him ride and just ride it with him, and hopefully he gets to the bottom.
And all fingers crossed for him. Get it, homie. Go get it.
And the 25-year-old Graham Agassi is set to drop on run number one. He hails from Kamloops, British Columbia. Right now, Brandon Semenuk is the leader. Tomas Janone sits in second, and Cam Zink in third. But this man has it all in front of him, Cam, and he has the abilities to walk away with the title. He just has to step up and take it.
It's actually mind-boggling to think that Graham Agassi has never won a Rampage event. He embodies what free ride is all about. He's such a quintessential Rampage competitor, yet he's never won. He's qualified first 3 times in a row and finally been able to drop in for his final run right here. It's great to see. Starting out with perfect form right now. That top drop, so steep and technical. Suicide no-hander up on the ridge. Huge motocross style tabletop on the hip, and then kicking out the back end, throwing the dust. Oh, the big step down, and he takes his hands off. Suicide no-hander. We haven't seen anybody trick something that size yet this year. The last drop, slowly rotating that backflip. We saw him over-rotate last year. There we go, a tabletop on the hip. Smooth run in the bag on a really, really difficult, highly scored line for Graham Agassi.
And still the dust settling, giving an idea of just how fast he came down this course. Graham Agassi's got one in the books and one still to go, and that was an impressive ride.
It seems like he was just starting that run. He made his way from top to bottom so fast, starting out with that big drop right here. That's the drop that Andrea Lacondeggi used to win the event last year. It's what Aggie has used the last 2 years to qualify first. And of course, the style on that hip. Another rider where you can see a silhouette of them and know who it is.
As we go on board, the GoPro footage is absolutely amazing. And Cam, he's not rocking any gloves.
That just goes to show, this guy is a man's man. Out here, the gnarliest bike event in the world, doesn't even wear gloves.
So what will the judges give Graham Agassi? He has been here so many times before. Is this the run? As the score comes in our two-run format, it is going to be a 94-75, and Agassi goes into first place.
That's got to feel great.
He absolutely looks stunned, and he's standing by with Tina Dixon.
And Aggie, you got your line from top to bottom, and it's in the finals. How long have you been waiting for this?
It's been a long time coming. I haven't like made it this far in a few years. It's been quite the build up, and I'm just happy that everyone's supporting me and everyone's getting down clean. Sucks that Paul went down. I hope he's doing okay.
Yeah, and you spent some time up top just assessing the situation. How important is it for you riders to be able to talk to the others to see how the course is doing?
It's super important. Those flags do little justice. It's getting pretty windy. I'll be lucky to get a second run, so it's good to have my friends up there. Let me know how it's going, and yeah.
Well, congrats on getting the run in the finals from top to bottom, guys.
Thank you, Tina. So it's Graham Agassi on top with Brandon Semenuk, Tomas Janone, and Cam Zink sitting in fourth. Right now, let's check in with Sal Masekela.
Rampage began back in 2001 and now celebrates its 10th edition anniversary. As you can imagine, like with any other sport, a lot has changed and evolved. In the olden days, riders had a little bit of help with shovels and rakes and basically had to point it straight downhill. Today's competitors have four-man build teams, and they have a week worth of time with the help of picks and sandbags to sculpt their ultimate lines, which now include massive man-made wooden features that have pushed this sport far beyond what anyone could have thought of 9 events ago.
So much effort, man. It's not easy. Not everyone can just build this stuff. You gotta be pretty experienced.
Yeah, the building is huge. It's almost like 80% of Rampage, I'd say.
Somebody was asking me, since I've been to every single one of them, how much is digging changed, and it's changed a lot.
In the first edition, people were literally just looking at what's already pretty much rideable and scratching a line a little bit with a rake and then just bombing down it.
Back in the day, we used to show up, you know, maybe you bring a shovel, maybe you wouldn't. We used to never even think about watering a lip, you know, it was like,
happened in 2004. Water fell from the sky, and I feel like everybody went, holy cow, if you add water to this dirt, you can make it do whatever you want.
2008, that was the first year of pre-built features by the event.
Nowadays, forced to do more elaborate builds, bring up sandbags, and now everyone has build crews.
Now, with the level it is, your dig team is equally as important as your riding.
The building has evolved, which has allowed the riding to evolve. It's kind of just been a, you know, a push and shove between building and riding to progress the sport as a whole. And now in the 10th edition, as you can see, you've got some ridiculous lines. Nobody would be able to even build these lines back then because the techniques didn't exist.
It's pretty cool. Everything evolves, and it's kind of fun to see how it changes every year.
And a tip of the hat to all the build crews. Cam McCall, you were a part of that as we get a look at our leader right now, Graham Agassi.
Yeah, it's crazy how much work goes into it. It's about a week, everybody just shoveling, blowing their backs out, but it's all worth it when your rider stomps their line.
Agassi is the leader, followed by Brandon Semenuk, Tomas Janone sitting in third, and this is Kurt Sorgi. The Canadian invasion continues, and I don't know what they're feeding them up north, but these guys all have just wicked skills.
Turns out Canadians love big mountains and ride bikes, a lot of suspension underneath them. Now, Kurt Sorgi returning after 2 years of injury. Andrea Lekondegi may technically be the defending champ out here, but Sorgi, last time he dropped in, he won, so he's trying to defend that title.
Kurt Sorgi looking for something that many people never get a chance at, and that is a second title at Rampage.
Backflip across from rider's left to rider's right of that ridge after coming off that really steep plumb drop down to the middle section of the course. Oof. Oh, now Kurt Sorgi putting his stamp on that hip with his interpretation of a motocross whip. Now he's gonna double this step down as well, going so deep, but not even really getting a bunch of head bob. There we go, he's got one last jump to nail a huge trick. Oh, a backflip tuck no hander with just as much extension as we saw from Tomas Janone.
Oh my.
Kurt Sorgi, not a slope-style competitor anymore, more of a big mountain specialist, but with the extension on that flip no-hander, you wouldn't know it.
Kurt Sorgi with a fantastic first run from top to bottom. Cam McCall, that run had everything in it.
It absolutely had everything. You said it, Todd. It had the tall, steep technical drop at the start, traversing over into the trickable features. You get an onboard view right there of just how vertical that drop is. Coming into this lip completely blind, he has no idea where he's landing until he comes around from this flip and thankfully sees his landing right there in front of him. And the suicide no-hander up on the ridge. Photographers just snapping off the photos. And he had a bit of a whip to that table, yep. Really motocross influenced. And here was the amplitude going even further than we'd seen before on that thing. No feet slipping off the pedals,
but the hands flying off the bars upside down with that backflip tuck no-hander.
The landings were clean. Kurt Sorge from top to bottom, very fast. The pace was high. The fans absolutely loved it. What is the score going to be? It's going to be a 96.50, wow. And Kurt Sorge of Canada goes into first. And the leader is standing by with Tina.
And Kurt Sorge just took the lead with that run. In fact, you haven't competed at Rampage since your victory in 2012. And to come back and take the lead with that run, how did you approach this?
Yeah, it's tough coming back after 2 years, after injuries. You know, I want to be here. I want to ride with the guys and progress with the event and the sport and everyone else. And I don't know. It's these guys are all sending it so big and riding so well. Just to try and match their level, I just really have to push myself, and just happy to be down at the bottom.
Yeah, and Aggie came up to you when you got here to the bottom. What did he say to you?
We're best bros from way back. Just, I love you, man. That was awesome, and I'm just happy that he made it down, and just happy to make it down, and just best of luck to all the riders that got hurt, and just stoked to be down here.
Well, and each one of you guys keep stepping it up and improving, so congratulations, guys.
All right, thank you, Tina. Kurt Sorge now has set the bar to beat 96.50, and he talked a little bit about the conditions, and everyone's just happy to get to the bottom, Cam. As we know, late in the afternoon here in Utah, the winds can pick up, so that's always an issue. Everyone trying to get one good run in, and this is Kyle Strait, a two-time champion here at Rampage.
He won in 2004 when he was a little kid. He won in 2013, right on the left side of your screen there on Venue 2 when he was a manimal. And, you know, he has to use all those strategic techniques that he used to win on two separate venues right now.
Look at this.
The venues change, the sport changes, and so he has a plan set up right now that could get a great score if he can pull it together.
Big, steep drops early on for Kyle Strait, the 28-year-old out of Alpine, California.
Now he's coming into a new step down right here. He crashed on it in practice. All right, he's been planning a trick. Looks like he's got a C-grab toboggan on that right there. And stepping back high up onto that hip landing that we saw Sorge just hit last run. Oh, wow! So much extension on that suicide no-hander from Kyle Strait. That's a trick he used to win the last two times that he won. And he needs another trick right here, but it looks like he got a little bit G'd out on that takeoff. He's a big guy and coming into that lip so fast. He did a Superman on that jump last year, possibly could have been thinking the same thing, but just under a little bit too much G pressure on that, but able to recover and get his feet back onto the pedals before the finish line.
So Kyle Strait comes through the finish line, maybe not the best run of his career, but this was stellar at the top.
That's the steep section that you saw Cam Zink ride. Kyle Strait actually has to corner more riders right to be able to connect to his line. That's his new step down feature you saw right there. He's getting a toboggan off of that. But nobody does a suicide no-hander off a drop quite as well as Kyle Strait, muscling through the landing. And definitely that's what Kyle Strait used to win in the past, and he's trying to do it again.
So the score for Strait comes in as an 82 in our two-run format. That will put him in seventh place for the time being. And there is our current leader, Kurt Sorge, 2012 champion with a two-peat in sight. But there's another rider looking to two-peat, 2014 champion, Andrea Lacondeguy.
And there'd be nothing better than being able to do it back-to-back. Nobody's ever done that before. The only two-time champ was Kyle Strait. He did it in 04 and 2013, so a big gap in between those two wins.
So the 28-year-old from Spain is on course, and he's got the mix of everything, though, Cam. He's technical. He doesn't mind the big drops, and look at this way to start.
It's true. He spends all year on his downhill bike these days, and it's definitely paid off with his victory last year. He had another year riding the Fest Series, getting comfortable on that big bike, comfortable with the big terrain, and tricking that train as well. Wow! Oh man, a flat spin cork 450 on that hip that most riders are just styling out. And airing out the double. Man, he's almost at the bottom of the course already. It seems like he just started this run. The speed and fluidity is off the charts.
Mark to beat a 96.50, and Andrea was after it.
Another corked out rotation on that trick jump, and another flip on this hip. He's gone upside down three times, and I swear he just left the start gate 3 seconds ago.
That might have been the quickest top to bottom run we've seen here at Rampage, and the defending champion absolutely smokes the course, but will it be enough to overtake Canada's Kurt Sorge?
Well, this run just went by so fast. We got to watch it in slow-mo just to savor the good bits. Coming off that creepy drop, we saw Sorgi ride the same exact line. They partner up on the build crew, get their buddies to help them out. But the thing that we did not see any other rider do was spin that hip. That's exactly the spirit of Rampage. Do a crazy trick on a crazy feature. That's how you get the most points. And if you can do so many tricks on crazy features in the span of just one run, you know, the judges are just going to be blazing through the ink on that paper.
Back-to-back backflips for the defending champion. As his score comes down, what will it be? The judges give him a 95.75 for Andreo, so he goes into second place just behind Kurt Sorgi. So back to the top we go. And this will be none other than Canada's Darren Bearclaw, the 33-year-old from British Columbia, an absolute legend in the sport.
We talk about how it's amazing that Graham Agassi has never won a Rampage title. The same can be said about Darren Bearclaw. He's the guy who's pioneered all these new zones since they moved from the original venue, yet he still hasn't won an event. Oh, it looks like he's got some trouble up there on the top ridge. I'm not sure if maybe he just cooked in too fast and missed his connect corner, or maybe he's got some sort of a mechanical. It almost looks like he's kind of looking at his front tire. It looks like maybe he's got a front flat, and there's no way you'd be able to even coast down any line on this course without full air pressure in both your tires.
Unfortunately for Darren, his run is done. So after one run, it is Kurt Sorgi on top with a 96.50 ahead of the defending champion. Look at Graham Agassi checking into third, and Cam Zink still in the hunt, sitting in sixth place. Well, the riders today have been pushing the boundaries, and we've seen some massive crashes. Let's throw it down to Tina, who's with Nikolai Rogatkin, to talk about his experience in qualifying.
And Nikolai, it was one of the biggest crashes that we have ever seen here at Rampage, and we're just so happy to see you up and better, and you even got back up on your bike, but give us your perspective.
Oh, it was absolutely the craziest crash I've ever experienced. You know, tumbling down that cliff, I couldn't stop myself, and, you know, I was just waiting to go unconscious, but I stopped finally and got up, checked if my bike was okay, and put my helmet back on. Got the okay from the judges to drop, not really the okay from the medics, but went anyway and finished my run, so.
And you surprised a lot of people by not only getting up, but even hitting that canyon gap. What surprises have you seen today? Because there's been some riding that has blown people's minds.
Oh, today has been absolutely chaotic. You know, it's giving me the chills to watch these guys do the stuff that they do. It's absolutely insane. The craziest riding I've ever seen, for sure. So I'm glad to be alive after that crash and here watching this chaos unfold.
Yeah, well, thanks for spending some time with us. Guys, a lot more riding left to go. We'll send it back to you.
Thank you, Tina. Cam, in all your years, have you ever seen a fall like that?
I agree with Tina. I think that's the most dramatic looking crash I've ever seen in the history of Rampage. To see him get back up, we never want to see somebody go down, but to see him finish his run, that was extraordinary.
Back to the top of the mountain. Next up, Mr. Fairclough set to drop in here on run number two.
But while we were away, we had Ryan Howard drop in for his second and final run. He had a couple things that he could have improved on this run. He wanted to trick that first jump in his line, but kind of able to add a little bit more flair on that dump 360 on the last jump, going a little bit more cork than he even had on the first run. Wasn't able to improve his score in the second run, so he'll be sticking with that run one score.
66.75, Remy Metallier of France also dropping on run two.
Remy Metallier once again blitzed from top to bottom, riding all these sections faster than anybody else on the course. He held the extension of that suicide no-hander over the canyon gap even longer this time, and was actually able to get his hands off of the final jump in his line right there. You see the handlebars jiggling back and forth. He coasted that one smoothly to the finish line.
And he does improve 82.50, so he cracks the top 10, and we are set to go. Brendan Fairclough, run number one, he got a 77 even. Now, we've talked about the conditions here, and all the riders have mentioned the wind picking up just a little bit, and that is something the organizers will keep an eye on.
You're never guaranteed to get two runs. That's what the format says, but you're out here in the middle of the desert. You never know what the weather's gonna do, so you really have to send it and run one, hoping that you can get an opportunity to improve it. Brendog right here is lucky enough to get an opportunity to try to improve his score. He had a couple things in his run one that he could probably try to make a little bit better. So you really unique line, starting from all the way riders right, making his way all the way riders left, doing a lot of traversing on unique features that he's the only one who rides. Seeing that left-hand berm there, this is his lily pad feature. He flips it again.
Yep.
Oh, even smoother this time. Doesn't have to put a foot down to get back on track.
snaking his way through the fans there on the side of the mountain, and one of the big drops here as he works his way over on this very precarious line.
You know, a lot of riders to get over on this section of the hill, they ride the ridge. He has his own unique line in the guts just to be able to get over here. Only rider hitting this GoPro step down. Nice style off that, a little bit of manual. We talk about Brendan Fairclough being a racer, one of the few racers who still comes out to compete at Rampage, and there's one of those race-influenced tricks right there, whipped out one-hander, grabbing his face mask on his helmet. And he gets his hands off on a step down, a suicide no-hander, to finish things off for Brendan Fairclough.
Cam, really a unique line for him, as you pointed out. He is really off the far left-hand side as we look up the mountain off to our right.
Yeah, the whole thing is basically a billy goat with that lily pad, a lot of stuff that he had in his line last year and was able to improve upon it with all the dig days this year.
Two safe runs complete. Remember, his first run score was a 77, but we only keep your best score. I think this one is going to be better.
So here's that lily pad. He jumps across the canyon gap, only touches down for a second, across another canyon gap, and he flips that second gap. His first run, he put a foot down. He was able to iron out the kinks there, leaving both feet on the pedals. There we go. One-hander, it looked like, off of that step down. And grabbing the face mask, just kind of like acting like a moto guy, getting the tear off, pulled off. Classic Brendan Fairclough style.
And his second run score, it will be an improvement, an 85.50. So he jumps up into seventh place, and his day is done as we look up towards the top. And there you see the telltale sign. That is not something these guys want to see. The flags are really starting to fly in the wind. Sam Reynolds is in the gate and ready to go, and he's going to make a run of this thing. But with an 83, he's in a pretty good position right now, currently in eighth.
He rode that first run so confidently for a rookie in Rampage competition. He's been spending so much time on the big bike this year, and his confidence in a questionable scenario, doing a trick that you wouldn't normally see on a mountain bike or in Rampage, you know, he's not really being affected by those flags right now, because you can see he's still got confidence on his bike. But I'm wondering, will he try those same tricks now that the flags have a little bit more movement to them?
So the wind really picking up here as he launches off here and is able to put it to the wheels.
Well, he's adding new tricks that he didn't have in his first run. He's flipping his own jump, a step down that connects onto Ridge 2 right there, and making his way into the canyon gap once again. Will he try a Superman again? Look at that blue flag ripping in the wind. It's a headwind. Oh, he still goes for it. Just as good an extension on that Superman across the canyon gap, despite the headwind.
Sam Reynolds is on a tear here, now towards the bottom.
He tries to sidewinder. There it is, Todd. That's the wind. It'll have an effect on you if you're riding straight, especially if you're off the side of your bike with no limbs touching it.
A great sign to see Sam Reynolds up. He makes it all the way to the bottom third section of this course on run number two. And despite the wind, Cam McCall, he absolutely went for it.
The confidence to try those tricks, knowing that the flags are howling, it's absolutely amazing, especially for a Rampage rookie. There's that step down flip. He's really got to control his speed because he's going straight down the mountain once he lands. That Superman, just as big of extension in the wind as it was in his first run. But here's where it all went wrong. The no-fit-a-can, no-hander, we call it the sidewinder. He landed without his bike. Still a lot of style in that crash, but not the kind of style the judges reward.
Unfortunate for him, his day is done, so he will stick with the 83 that he picked up in run number one. Well, the stakes and the winner picking up this afternoon here in Virgin. Let's check in with Tina Dixon, who's standing by with Cam Zink.
And we just got word that Cam Zink will not be taking a second run. Cam, what is behind that decision?
Kind of did all I can, you know. We show up, we build a line, we put our heart into it and countless hours, and then I rode it, and that's kind of a win in our book, you know, just to get able to accomplish that, you know, because you lay out your own course, and it was nerve-wracking and the burliest line I've ever ridden, and come down and then see your boys coming through and just knocking you down the ticker, and they're all apologizing, saying, like, I'm sorry, like, and it's like, it's not your fault, guys. So it's not worth it to try to gain. They're not liking what I'm doing today, so it wouldn't be worth it for fifth or maybe fourth, you know, so it is what it is.
So there's some strategy in play, obviously.
Yeah, you lay out the best run you can. You think you can't pick what they're judging, but they seem to be really, really liking that ridge, you know, that's the winning ridge. And for originality's sake, I think should get a little higher score, but, you know, it's in the judges' hands, and I did all I can. And happy to be down one piece, hanging out with my wife and my daughter.
And you had such an impressive line, and it's always so much fun to see you out ride. Enjoy the time with the family. Thanks for speaking with us.
Thank you very much. Have a good one.
Okay, guys.
Thank you, Tina, and thank you, Cam. And Cam McCall, does he make the right decision?
I think he's making the perfect decision, actually. He did exactly what he set out to do, and the only thing he doesn't have control over is what the judges decide to do with that score. And, you know, he did his job today. He can feel good about that.
Bas van Steenbergen, while we're away, took his second run as well.
Bas definitely adding a little bit more to this line, a little bit even more fluidity, if you can believe it, than the run one. Off of those drops and that long gap that he has at the bottom that nobody else even has the ability to get the speed for, putting that down.
He gets an identical score in run number two, a 70.50. Brett Reeder also taking his second run.
Well, a lot on the line for Brett Reeder here. He needed to beat Thomas Chenon's score, and he had a great plan of how to do that. He had the 360, he had the flat drop backflip, and then he needed to get the opposite 360 off the last drop. Unfortunately, spinning his opposite direction, came up a little bit weird on the rotation, a little bit sideways, slid out. It's not going to be his day.
And that score, the 51.75, doesn't help his cause either.
And it also doesn't help the war. Rampage is the battle, but he's trying to get that FMB overall. He doesn't beat Thomas Chenon's score, so Thomas Chenon will be the FMB World Tour overall winner.
So Brandon Semenuk now set to drop in business at hand, his second run. He's sitting on a 94, which has him currently in fourth.
And Kurt Sorge is sitting above him in that 96.5 score, sitting in first place. In any freeride mountain bike competition, if you're sitting in the hot seat and Brandon Semenuk still has a run to go, you cannot feel confident that you can still win the event. Oh, wow, already improving on his first run there. A backflip, one-footed can off the flat drop, putting his foot over the top tube.
So these guys spend so much time on the build crew, and then they come out and put together a great run. How hard is it to change in mid-run and add something after run number one?
I think Brandon, he's so strategic. He already has a plan what he's going to do in run one. If it goes well, he has a plan of what he's going to do to up that score. So I'm just curious to see what he does on this last trick jump here.
So working possibly on a plan B is Brandon Semenuk, and his plan B is better than most anyone else's plan A. The score he wants to beat is a 96.50.
Well, there's the jump that matters most, and he gets a backflip one-footed can again. Looked like he was going for something more, possibly trying to take his hands off after putting his foot over the top tube, getting that quirked out flat spin 450 on the last jump. He improved his score by doing that flat drop one-footed can backflip, but I think he needed a little bit more on that last double.
94 is the score that Brandon Semenuk has in run number one, looking for much more. In our two run, we only keep the best score.
Smooth yet again off this start drop. Once again, he's the only one who's riding that drop. And right here, the flat drop backflip, no lift to help him get behind the bike. He does the one-footed can. Once again, on the double jump, the backflip, one-footed can. Looked like he put his bars in his lap trying to take the hands off. They just didn't come off. But another smooth flat spin 450 on this thing. And he will up his score on this. It may not be enough to move his position, though.
So in the two-run format where we only keep your best score, Brandon Semenuk's day is done. He picks up a 94.25 on run number two, but it's only good enough to put him into fourth place. So with only a handful of riders remaining, the wind conditions are not looking good. The wind's certainly picking up. Currently in third, it's Graham Agassi. Andrea Lacondeguy sits in second place, and our current overall leader, Kurt Sorge, holding the top spot to beat with a 96.50. In our 10th edition here in Virgin, Utah, there are only a few riders remaining, and the crowds here are set to see us crown a new champion. As we head back up to the top of the hill, this is Pierre-Edouard Ferry of France, set to drop in. Now, his first run score cam was solid, a 78.50, but the wind is certainly picking up.
Yeah, I'm having a hard time even imagining him riding this line any smoother than he did in his first run. His first run was so good. Now, on an optimistic way of looking at it, you got more wind here. That's not good for anybody, but he's a rider who kicks up such a huge trail of dust. It looks so cool, and when the wind's picking up that dust, you know, it's not gonna be easier to ride out here, but it sure is gonna look way cool. Suicide no-hander making his way across from left to right of that ridge. And he's playing up the wind right now. He's kicking his back end out, throwing up the plumes, knowing how cool it looks for everybody watching. Here's a really technical descent on his line right now. He's touching down one, two, three, and four times. He's got to monitor his speed, because if he overclears any one of those, he's going all the way to the bottom.
So the oldest rider in today's competition at 34 out of France, Ferry making his way down this big feature, and he still goes for the backflip.
Another perfectly timed rotation on flipping that jump, carrying so much speed, able to make it all the way to the landing on that hip. Some riders coming up short, not Pierre-Edward Ferry, very precise, able to carry the speed, pump the back end of the bike, make it all the way down to the finish line, pull the air brake with style.
And he is stoked. He had a 78.50. What do you think, Cam? This has got to be better.
You know, I said at the top of this run, I couldn't imagine him improving the score, but he rode that with so much more conviction. I feel like it's totally possible that he may improve that.
Looking for a 96.51. That would put him out in front as the judges come together and get their score for Pierre-Edward Ferry, and it comes in as an 81.75, so an improvement, but not enough to crack the top 10. And now the pace picking up, riders getting in position. If there is a break in the wind, they are gonna send them, and it looks like Darren Bearclaw is gonna drop on that second run. Remember, he did not finish his first run, had some kind of mechanical, but the young man set to drop in from Canada, he's saying, I didn't come all this way to Virgin, Utah not to get a full pull.
This is what makes Darren Bearclaw Darren Bearclaw. He epitomizes big mountain free riding. He had his movie, Where the Trail Ends, where he went all over the world trying to find new big mountain zones. And when you're filming, sometimes you're in this crazy zone, you just have to drop because the light's good and the camera's there. So even though it's windy right here, he's the one guy to step up and say, hey, you know what? I've got my line ready. I know it's not ideal. I'm gonna drop in.
And there are sections on the course where the wind isn't as bad. Obviously the ridgeline is much worse.
Yeah, when you're facing different directions, a side wind is the worst, a headwind is second worst, a tailwind is a little bit not as bad as both of those because you can just use your brakes to monitor a little bit. But he's going all over this mountain, so he's gonna experience the wind from all different directions.
And how about that seat? If you're a fan here and willing to make the hike, you get up and close and personal. And look at this, Darren Bearclaw absolutely scorching through the desert.
Good size step down leading into this final road gap. He stomps the road gap. I know he was planning a trick on that, but with the wind, sometimes you got to alter your plan a little bit. A tabletop on the quarter pipe, waving the crowd. That was a good solid run, especially in these conditions for Darren Bearclaw.
So he does get a full pull from top to bottom. Run number one, he did not finish, but here he is in the two-run format. Will he keep your best score? And this is going to be a solid score for Darren. Did you see enough there, Cam, to bump him into the 90s, however?
I feel like it was amazing that he was able to drop in on that one. He was in a position where he did not have a run one score to try to beat. He had a DNF. So all he needed to do is make it from top to bottom, try to salvage this. And the bigger picture of this whole competition is that next year, they base the qualifying automatics off of your placing from the prior year. So even if he can't execute his plan as ideally as he wants to with all the tricks, he still can hopefully finish in the top 12.
So Darren possibly looking to 2016, which will be the 11th edition of Rampage presented by GoPro. The score comes in at 87. So Darren does get himself a top 10 position here in Virgin, Utah. The wind still is blustery on top of the starting area. And here's the situation, Cam. You've got two guys in podium positions that are thinking maybe now is not the time to drop for run two.
Aggie and Andreu have found themselves in a very interesting predicament. They're up here sitting in podium position already, which means a lot because at the end of the day, all you have control over is executing your line. You don't have control over how the judges perceive that run. So to sit in a podium position, that's the goal for everybody. Now to risk everything, you know, life and limb, to try to better an already, you know, seemingly perfect run, I'm not sure if it's worth it for these guys.
Graham Agassi and Andrea Lacondigue up on top of the start house, and it is official. They will not take their second runs, which means Kurt Sorge is your champion in 2015.
That has to feel absolutely amazing for Kurt Sorge. I know after 2 years with two different broken legs missing the last two Rampages, he's coming into this thing going, do I still belong? The entire mountain's tracked out. It's a new venue. He didn't know where he fit in, but he found a line. He won the event.
So a Canadian reigns supreme in Southern Utah in the 10th edition. It is Kurt Sorge picking up his second victory at Rampage. Lacondigue gets second, Graham Agassi in third. Good run for Semenuk Janone, and Cam Zink rounds out the top six. What a day here in Utah, but in the end, Mother Nature had the final say as we send it down to Tina Dixon, who's with our champion.
And Kurt, you put everything in that first run and it paid off. But last year you weren't even able to ride this mountain. So what did you think when you first saw this venue?
It's gnarly. Especially the middle ridge where we ended up going. All the boys had such gnarly lines, and it showed. Everyone's super tight. Everyone nailed their run really good, and like, I'm just stoked to make it down and be able to ride with those guys and be a part of it this year.
Well, and your last win here was in 2012, the last time you actually rode, and since then you've had your injuries, you've had your time on the couch. So to come back and win, what does this represent to you?
I just can't believe it. I don't know, I try and work hard, and I'm just stoked it paid off, and yeah, I just can't believe it still. Yeah, it feels like a dream.
Yeah, well, you need a couple days to let it sit in, I'm sure. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Guys.
Thank you, Tina. What an amazing job by Kurt Sorge and the rest of the athletes here at Rampage. We saw some incredible boundary-pushing action today, and let's take a look at our Red Bull signature moment. There have been so many amazing lines built here at Rampage, but perhaps the most ambitious is Cam Zinks. So ambitious, in fact, it took 2 years to complete. He started last year, but ran out of time to connect the bottom portion. This year, his build crew worked tirelessly to finish the lower features and give the line two of the most impressive moves of the day. Not only is his huge natural 360 drop the biggest in the sport's history, but Zink manages to keep his speed right into the hip, through the canyon gap, and into the massive step down where he added a backflip. This year's Red Bull signature moment goes not only to Cam Zink, but his entire build crew for creating one of the most impressive lines in mountain bike history. Congratulations to Cam and company. Well, Cam McCall, the 10th edition certainly lived up to its billing.
We always know coming into this event that it's gonna push boundaries, not only of riding, but building and just vision. The foresight to create these lines that are gonna push what we know as free ride mountain biking into the next generation. It's gonna impact what we see next year, and we're on to a new chapter.
And we can't wait for 2016. And with that, we check in with Sal.
Thank you, Todd. An incredible day here from the edge of the magnificent Zion National Park near Virgin, Utah. And thank you, fans, for hanging out with us. We had big expectations for Red Bull Rampage, and we certainly over-delivered. Rampage truly awe-inspiring, both in this incredible setting and what these athletes are able to do as they make their way down this course. Congratulations to our winner once again, Kurt Sorge, his second Rampage win, and to the happy guy, Andreu Lecondeguy and Graham Agassi for rounding out the podium, and a shout out to Thomas Janon for winning the 2015 FMB Diamond Series title. We will see you next year. I'm gonna make a deal with the bad boy. She's a bad boy.
Opportunity to update you on the crash that Paul Bassagodia had during the broadcast. He did sustain a spinal cord injury, and he has a long road to recovery, but he's at the nation's best rehab facility working so hard every day and making constant progress. You can follow Paul's recovery story and show your support on iRideForPaul.com.